starting to filter back in, you know. I'll use a little hunting analogy. You can kick game out of an area, and then after a while, guess what? They start filtering back in. And so you weren't kicked. Well, I guess we were kicked out. But
they come back for the nourishment.
Yes, we're coming back. So great to have you joining us at home, Marlet Chul, Bobby Brown, and I think it's official now. Glenn Sladek said, you are the man. So I have two people who have witnessed to that. So I always kid that at home, Beth is the man, you know. So we kind of have a role slip in certain flip in certain things. Well, great to have you here. And as we begin, we want to just welcome you. I'm Pastor Tom Rakel of the Grace Bible Church. If you're watching online, we've had a lot of people watching online, and now some of those people are here now. So great to have you. Yeah, give yourselves a hand there, okay? There we go. And I do want to make a couple of announcements. Prayer time this week at 7 o'clock on Wednesday. We're going to open that back up. We do need to clean down each time. If anybody wants to volunteer to help do that this morning, kind of where people and all the surfaces where we've touched, we're kind of coming in and going out, so it's actually pretty easy right now. Men's Bible study, we're going to try and kick that off on Saturday at from 7 to 9. We will not have any refreshments. If you want to drink coffee, you need to bring your own or, you know, juice or whatever you may bring. Good to see Tracy out there as well. Any other announcements that need to be made that maybe I haven't made? I will maybe next week recognize we have some graduates, so we'll be recognizing them, maybe not up here, but we have a gift for them. Mary Govrick was kind enough to wrap those gifts, so we will be forwarding those on, getting them to the graduates in some way. Also helping up front this morning, our musicians. And maybe you want to pan over there and so they can lift their hand as I say their names. So we have Lily Nickel, there we go, Josiah Behrens, and Daryl Willett, there we go. Well, the real, I could have said the same all the same time. And also up front, Paul Nickel and then Laszlo Govrick will be reading a portion of scripture. I'll be preaching from 2 Chronicles chapter 16. Laszlo will be reading from Psalm 43, which I think will be an encouragement to all of you. And we'll have three songs today. We've been having two, but we're having three today. We're not doing any congregational singing because that is one way in which it's transferred further. So we won't be doing that for a while. But you can be making melody in your heart. I guess that's the way to do it. And so as we begin, I'm going to have one of our elders, Paul Nickel, will come and open us in prayer.
Good morning. Good to see everybody here. Nice that you could watch online. And I just want to give a praise the Lord for my eyes. I had eye surgery and my second eye is done now, and they're both working really good. So I'm just really pleased and blessed.
He can even see you at home right now as you're watching. That is
like
incredible.
Bionic man, I got a couple of bionic eyes here.
He can't see at home, so don't get nervous about that.
I can imagine it, though. Okay, let's come to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you and in a great country that we have, Lord, and we thank you for each member of this church. Pray that you'd be with them and bless them wherever they are today. And Lord, we lift up the Oy family as they're still grieving the loss of Arnie, and we miss him, but we know he's in a better place. And also the Don Martin family, Lord, we lift them up, and we remember hearing Don's encouraging messages and words to us for many years. We also want to lift up Helen Young's son-in-law today, Lord. Forrest, as he's going for cancer treatment ongoing, and we just pray that you'd bless that effort, Lord. And we ask a blessing on Pastor's message today, too. Lord, we look around us, we see things in our country that are disturbing, and we would have to agree that it's evil at work, Lord, and darkness. But we love you, Lord. You are the truth. We love the truth. We love justice. We love your law. And you are the light, Lord. Mm-hmm. And where you are, there is no darkness. We come against the evil that we see, and we know that it comes from a lack of you, Jesus, in this world. Mm-hmm. And from the result of sin that came into the world, Lord. And we just ask you to intervene, Lord. Mm-hmm. Help our country in this troubled times. Your word said that in the world we'll have troubles, but you leave us your peace, Lord, so that we can be where you are. Now we lift up this service. We lift up this church. Mm-hmm. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Yeah.
Good morning. I'm a little wobbly. It's nice to see all of you here again this morning, and I guess I was waiting for the signal from Pastor when to come up here. But if we want to read Psalm 43, and I've just read it through several times, and it is really strong. You do feel, as a believer, that if there was no one else with you, God is always with you. And I just feel that strength in this congregation, in this church. And again, I'm so pleased to be here in this church again this Sunday. Psalm 43. Vindicate me, O God, and plead my cause against an ungodly nation. Rescue me from deceitful and wicked men. You are God, my stronghold. Why have you rejected me? Why must I go about mourning, oppressed by the enemy? Send forth your light and your truth. Let them guide me. Let them bring me to your holy mountain, to the place where you dwell. Verse 4. Then will I go to the altar of God, to God my joy and my delight. I will praise you with the harp, O my God, my God. Why are you downcast, O my soul? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Amen.
Well, as Pastor Tom said, good morning to you all. It's great to see you here this morning and all those that are watching online. So it's a powerful psalm that you just read, Laszlo. And just this next psalm we're going to sing, it's called You Never Let Go. And I just want to read one verse to you. We can never hear enough of the word. So Psalm 23:4, this is a famous psalm that a lot of you know. Just verse 4, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. In those passages that Laszlo read in this verse, just such applicable, relevant truth for all times, and especially in these times we're witnessing right now. So we pray that you're hoping you're blessed. This psalm is called You Never Let Go.
Fear no evil, for my God is with me. Whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Sin, oh no, you never let go. Through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go. In every high and every low.
Getting some nice compliments on your music after the first round. So great, thank you. If you have your Bibles, open up to 2 Chronicles chapter 16. And I had mentioned some of the people that are watching and kind of continuation, Sandy Pasusta, Dana Pasusta, Joey Hancock in Georgia, good friend of mine. Jeannie Ostreich, Sue Vashik, Kim and Pat Gertz, Ed Zahn in Wisconsin. Marvin Marlett's friend Ann is watching. And Marion and Monty, Helen Young is watching. And I will Pete and Debbie in Tennessee, Daryl's sister-in-law and brother-in-law. And so we have Pennsylvania, South Dakota, Georgia, Wisconsin, Tennessee, and Minnesota represented, right? We'll still include Minnesota. Yeah, let's give our watchers a hand, huh? All right. In 2 Chronicles chapter 16, we're told about King Asa. And Asa was a good king. In fact, after the division of the kingdom, after Solomon's failures. Remember, Saul was the first king, and then David, and then Solomon. And Solomon started out great, but he ended up basically compromising. He had failed to deal with some issues evidently early on, because he had this desire for foreign women, and he multiplied horses, and ultimately these things came back to bite him, kind of like a rattlesnake. Yeah. and that he had let in. And it came about when he was old, his wives turned his heart away from the Lord, and he began worshiping other gods, even building places of worship, even child sacrifice. I mean, how tragic. And it is a warning to us that any one of us can fall and take a big nosedive. And we want to finish strong. Well, Asa was a good king, but unfortunately, he kind of took a nosedive towards the end. Sadly, he didn't finish the race well. He was close to the finish line, and then he began depending on other things instead of upon the Lord. But in 2 Chronicles chapter 16, we're told about something that took place in his life as he was a king. Earlier, he brought about great reforms. He removed false worship. He even got rid of his grandmother, who was the queen mother, in a position and where she was bringing in idolatry. He removed her from that position. Even his own relative, he had to deal with his grandmother. And so he served the Lord. He was faithful to the Lord, and God blessed him. He had a situation where a great army of the Cushites, you think of North Africa, they came against Asa. And Asa, you can read about it in an earlier chapter, he cried out to God, and God brought about a great deliverance. And he depended upon the Lord. Well, later, he has another intrusion into his life. In 2 Chronicles 16, verse 1, in the 36th year of Asa's reign, he reigned 41 years. In the 36th year of Asa's reign, Baasha, king of Israel, went up against Judah. Now remember, I think one of the hard things when I became a Christian was to understand Israel and Judah. Well, what happened, of course, when you think of Israel, you think of Jacob when he wrestled with an angel and was blessed, and his name was changed from Jacob, the deceiver, to Israel, because as a prince, he had prevailed with God and with men. So when you think of Israel, it's a name for Jacob. When you think of Israel, you think of his descendants, the Israelites. And then when you also think of Israel, you think of the land of Israel. But following Solomon's departure, God tore the kingdom in half. So then Israel is referred to as the northern kingdom, and Judah is the southern kingdom. Israel, the northern kingdom, didn't have a good king. And they ultimately were carried off into exile. About 722, 721 BC, the Assyrians came down, conquered, took people away, and then brought other people groups in. And where we end up with the Samaritans is where those other people groups were brought in and basically began to influence the Jewish religion in that northern kingdom. 722, 721 BC is when the Assyrian captivity. Judah had some good kings, and Asa was one of those good kings. Ultimately, Judah came to a point where they would no longer listen to the prophets and what God was trying to say to them. And Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came in, destroyed the temple, destroyed all these things, carried away people captive. Daniel was one of those people carried away captive. And they spent 70 years in captivity, as God had said he was going to bring a judgment upon them. Well, so during this time, you have Israel, the northern kingdom, and Judah, the southern kingdom. And Israel, this northern kingdom, attacks, begins causing trouble with their own relatives, really. And we're told this, Baasha, king of Israel, went up against Judah and fortified Ramah to prevent anyone from leaving or entering the territory of Asa, king of Judah. Well, it was basically a blockade. or, you know, there would be cities that would be laid under siege where they couldn't come out, couldn't go in, you starve them out, you know, they have to surrender. And here, this northern king basically stops anything from coming in and going out. Well, you can only last so long that way. You know, we do similar things today, really, where we put sanctions. We try to stop oil from coming in or trade that takes place in order to apply pressure. Well, that was the case here. And so we see that this test came. And, you know, sooner or later, every person is tested by forces outside their control. Every single one of us experiences testings multiple times during our life. That's why we should be walking close to the Lord. And Asa was a man who had walked close to the Lord. And yet here was this situation. Many times great tests or trials are unwarranted and undeserved, but they still intrude into our life. Now, I don't think Asa deserved this, but here was this pressure that was being laid upon him. And what was he going to do? This was not something King Asa was seeking or deserving, but it still came his way. Tests and trials often reveal a weakness or a flaw within us. And I have seen certain individuals, and I've seen it in myself, but I've seen certain individuals, friends, that when the going gets tough, fear kicks in and they split. I've seen that happen. Or they back down or they shrink away or whatever. Well, we're all prone to do something like that. We want to make sure we're doing what God has called us to do. But here was this test that came. Henry Ward Beecher, he said, "It is trial that proves one thing weak and another strong. A house built on the sand is in fair weather just as good if it were built on a rock." You know, trials and testings reveal things about us, reveal our lack of commitment. Or it may reveal that we truly are dedicated to Christ. I'm still following him. I'm still standing. I haven't denied him. I haven't run away. I haven't forsaken the Lord, even though this has come upon me. Sometimes it reveals those things, or sometimes it reveals an area of weakness and temptation when it comes our way. We can be tempted. Well, we see this aggression against Asa in 2 Chronicles 16, and then we see this agreement that was made by Asa. So we see the aggression that came against him, and then the agreement that he made. Look at verses 2 to 6. "Asa then took the silver and gold out of the treasuries of the Lord's temple and of his own palace, and sent it to Ben-Hadad, king of Aram, who was ruling in Damascus. 'Let there be a treaty between me and you,' he said, 'as there was between my father and your father. See, I am sending you silver and gold. Now break your treaty with Baasha, king of Israel, so he will withdraw from me.' Ben-Hadad agreed with King Asa and sent the commanders of his forces against the towns of Israel. They conquered Ijon, Dan, Abel, Maim, and all the store cities of Naphtali. When Baasha heard this, he stopped building Ramah and abandoned his work. Then King Asa brought all the men of Judah, and they carried away from Ramah the stones and timber Baasha had been using with them when he built up Geba and Mizpah." So here, this aggression and then this agreement. Looks like he's solved the problem, right? He's paid his way out of this. He took materials, silver and gold that were for the temple, and now he's paying out. He's getting this guy, this northern kingdom off. He's kind of maneuvered behind, and he said, "You break your covenant there, and I'll give you this." And he did, and so then this king of Israel backs off. You know, a decision that may seem reasonable or even beneficial may not be a godly decision or the best decision. You know, I think of how Lot, when Abraham and Lot, herdsmen, and their God blessed them so that their herds grew and the land could not sustain them together. So Abraham did not want any division between him and his nephew. And he said, "You pick that land," because the herdsmen were starting to fight. He said, "You pick that land, and I'll pick this land." or that, you pick that land and I'll pick this land. You choose. He gave Lot the choice. And Lot looked and he saw that area that's now the area of the Dead Sea, and it was well watered everywhere, lush, like a great garden, like the Garden of Eden. It was just beautiful. Well, if you've been there today, it doesn't look like that. Back that Dead Sea, there are no fish in that Dead Sea. And it is a desolate area. But at that time, it looked good. Lot was looking at what seemed reasonable and logical. He had herds. Here is water, what a herdsman needs. Here was lush vegetation. And so we're told, and this is where the tragedy in Lot's life begins. He pitches his tent towards Sodom. Next time you see him, he's in Sodom. Then the next time you see him, he's at the gate of Sodom, a place of authority and acceptance and importance. And then you see him in a cave with his two daughters, having lost his wife, lost all his possessions. It looked good on the outside. Well, here was Asa, and it looked like a good decision. Relying on the Lord is more important than relying on riches. At an earlier date, Asa had relied upon the Lord, and the Lord responded to his prayer of desperation. In fact, during the years of peace, Asa had built up fortified cities and a military. We're told in 2 Chronicles 14, verse 9, Zerah the Cushite marched out against them with an army of thousands upon thousands and 300 chariots. Now, because of these reforms, Asa had peace. But he didn't just sit back in his easy chair and drink his iced tea or Kool-Aid, you know, but he built up the cities, he built up the military, because eventually there's going to be trouble. There always is. People are evil, and they were born that way. And yes, there's the stamp of God's image upon every human being. There's a little bit of good, but it's all tainted because we're fallen creatures. But here, this Cushite, as I mentioned earlier, came, and we're told this, how Asa responded to this previous attack in chapter 14. We're told this, then Asa called to the Lord his God and said, Lord, there is no one like you to help the powerless against the mighty. Help us, Lord our God, for we rely on you. And in your name we have come against this vast army. Lord, you are our God, so do not let mere mortals prevail against you. He prayed, and we're told this in 2 Chronicles 14, verse 12. The Lord struck down the Cushites before Asa and Judah. The Cushites fled. Now that's how he handled conflict previously. But now he's using the pocketbook. And it's no replacement for relying upon the Lord. And here you see this agreement that he made. When faced with a threatening situation, it's better to pray our way out than to pay our way out. And that's what Asa did not do the second time. The first time, he prayed his way out. We see this aggression. We see this agreement. And then we see an announcement made against Asa. Now, Asa was probably not used to having somebody come and rebuke him and confront him. He was king. It's a dangerous thing to go to a king and tell him off, right? But this prophet, this seer, he's called a seer, he was given an insight into the future and things like that. We're told this in verse 7 of 2 Chronicles 16. At that time, Hanani, the seer, came to Asa, king of Judah, and said to him, because you relied on the king of Aram and not on the Lord your God, the army of the king of Aram has escaped from your hand. See, God was going to give him a victory. Well, when he tried to take the easy way out, he lost out on the victory. And we can do that too. Rather than standing firm and staying steadfast, and we try to find some other way around it, we lose out every time. If we're not relying on the Lord, we're putting ourselves in a dangerous position. We're not the Cushites and Libyans, a mighty army with great numbers of chariots and horsemen. Yet when you relied on the Lord, he delivered them into your hand. For the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. You see, what God had done in the past, the great thing God had done for him in the past, made Asa responsible for the things he was experiencing now in the future. And because God had helped him in the past, he knew better than to rely upon his own understanding or to trust in the Lord with all our heart and lean not unto our own understanding. And here this prophet comes, the seer comes, and confronts him. When godly people are walking with the Lord, they are a blessing to those around them. When Asa was seeking the Lord was helping him and blessing everything he did. God was watching over him. He was with him. The way God has helped a person in the past should encourage that same person to look to him for help in the future. You know, David used this principle when he faced Goliath. When Saul tried to talk him out of it, King Saul, who should have been going out and coming against Goliath, when David was confronted by Saul, "You can't do it. You're just a child," and he's been a fighting man from his youth. And he tells about when he was watching his father's sheep, and a bear and a lion came, and he killed that bear and that lion. And he said, "The same God who delivered the lion and the bear into my hands will deliver this uncircumcised Philistine, this man who does not have a relationship with the living God." So here, Asa is being confronted because he had experienced, he had seen God's deliverance in the past from this tremendous situation. And now he's being confronted on about it. A failure to rely upon the Lord and choosing to rely upon some individual instead is an affront to God. And the Lord longs and looks for opportunities to help his people. But when we rely upon human help instead of heavenly help, we set ourselves up for failure. I want to ask you, are you relying upon the Lord? Am I relying upon the Lord? And you may be concerned about the future, but I want to challenge you to do this. Look back at specific times when you know God helped you, or God spoke to you, or God comforted you, or God encouraged you, or God led you. And at the time, you were somewhat fearful about it, maybe uncertain about it. But afterwards, you say, "Wow, God led me. I didn't realize what he was doing." Sometimes he brings us into friendships and relationships with other believers that will be vital in the future to help us, or we will help them. And here, Asa is being confronted. When we rely on anyone or anything rather than the Lord, we miss out on divine victories and we bring certain trouble on ourselves. When a godly person fails to walk in a fashion that is pleasing to the Lord, they bring harm to others and to themselves. We have a responsibility to keep depending upon God. You know, Paul confronted the Galatians because they had accepted Christ. Paul proclaimed the gospel to them. And then when he writes the letter of Galatians, he rebukes them. It's the harshest letter that I've seen that Paul wrote. He wrote about half the New Testament. But he confronts them because teachers had come in and said, "Yes, you started out by faith, but you, now you've got to keep these rules and regulations." And Paul confronts them, and he says, "Oh, you foolish Galatians, who has deceived you? Having begun in the Spirit, are you now perfected by the flesh?" You know, the Christian life is one in which we keep on. I would tell you there have been times, even the last few years, where I've had great doubts. But I also came to the conclusion, where else could I go except to the Lord? And I'm going to keep following him, even if it leads me off a cliff. Now, it's not going to happen like that, but I want to be steadfast. I want to be unmovable. I want to be always abounding in the work of the Lord, because we know our labor is not in vain in the Lord. We need to be fully committed to him. Asa had been committed to the Lord, and then when this trial came, suddenly he starts relying on other things. relying on his pocketbook, relying on a commitment that somebody else had made to somebody else to break that up. Well, we see the announcement, we see the aggression, we see the agreement, we see the announcement against Asa made by this seer. And he says this, and this is something I believe that you need to take home today and I need to take home today. It's been a great encouragement to me. And I believe it's as true as when it was spoken. As true as when this seer spoke it in the 800s BC. These words, "For the eyes of the Lord range throughout the earth to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him." Right now, God is looking at your heart and my heart and your heart, and he sees if you are fully committed to him. Is your heart fully committed to the Lord? We are to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our might, with all our everything we have. And here, this prophet says that God is looking for somebody to use and to work through. We see the anger of Asa. How unfitting this was. Look at verse 10 of 2 Chronicles 16. Asa was angry with the seer because of this. He was so enraged that he put him in prison. At the same time, Asa brutally oppressed some of the people. You see, divine truth proclaimed is either accepted or rejected. There's no in between. Do you realize that? There isn't, well, yeah, I'm going to do that at some point. Someday I'll do it. No, we either respond or we reject. Jesus said, "He that is not with me is against me. He that gathers not with me scatters abroad." So we are either committed to him and obeying him. We can't have excuses that somehow get us off the hook, because God knows the truth. When a person rejects the truth, they also reject the person proclaiming it. Do you realize that? That sometimes when a friend or a foe or a family member rejects some spiritual truth that you convey, they are really not rejecting you. You know, Samuel had this problem. Remember the Israelites, they wanted a king. They had had God leading them and guiding them, but they said, "We want a king," like a little two-year-old. "We want a king. We want a king. We want a king." Okay, well, finally God says, "Okay." And Samuel was very distraught about this. And he goes and talks to the Lord, and the Lord says to him, "Samuel, they have not rejected you. They have rejected me that I might rule over them." Was this seer, this prophet being rejected? Ultimately, God's word was being rejected. The truth that God was trying to convey to Asa was being rejected. You know, it's like going to the doctor and you say, "Well, I've got a sore leg here. I got a sore leg when I walk on it. It really hurts." So they run some tests, say, "You need surgery. Come on, I'm going to go get a second opinion on this." So you go to the next guy and he runs a few tests. He says, "You need surgery." "I'm going to get another opinion on this." So you get another one. "You need surgery." Ultimately, it's not really the doctor you're rejecting. It's the truth that the doctors are telling you. And so here, you think of this anger of Asa. Very unfitting. And here was this situation that now he is not only angry with the seer, but he brutally oppressed some of the people. When a person is not walking closely with the Lord, they are hurting the people of God and innocent people along the way. And finally, we see the affliction of Asa. Verses 11 through 14, the events of Asa's reign from beginning to end are written in the book of the kings of Judah and Israel. In the 39th year of his reign, Asa was afflicted with a disease in his feet. Though his disease was severe, even in his illness, he did not seek help from the Lord, but only from the physicians. Then in the 41st year of his reign, Asa died and rested with his ancestors. They buried him in the tomb that he had cut up for himself in the city of David. They laid him on a bier covered with spices and various blended perfumes, and they made a huge fire in his honor. Here we see the last couple of years of Asa's life. His feet are afflicted. Some have thought he had gout. A couple of different commentators say they believe it was gout. Whatever it was, God was trying to get his attention. Now, all of us have aches and pains. It doesn't mean that God is afflicting you or telling you, but I think in Asa's case, it was. God was trying to draw him back. And is there anything wrong with doctors? Absolutely not. I think of how when King Hezekiah was told to set his house in order because he was going to die and he wasn't going to live. Isaiah the prophet told him that. And when a prophet like Isaiah tells you that, it's pretty certain, you know. And so what did Hezekiah do? He turned his face to the wall and he wept. And then God spoke to Isaiah and he said, you go back and you tell him something. Tell him, I have seen his tears, I have heard his prayers, and I'm going to add 15 years to his life. And then there were these instructions given that he should make a fig poultice and apply it. So it wasn't that there was some natural remedy that was out the window. Ultimately, God brought the healing, but all healing is ultimately from him. Whether he uses a doctor or whether he uses, you know, some sort of medicine, I'm grateful for the different types of medicine that have helped me. You know, I take a type of chemo. I've done it for how many years now? I think probably 13, 14 years or something, because I have rheumatoid arthritis, and it cells from a rat spleen. Now, I want to tell you, God has a sense of humor. Because one of the things I hate the most are rats. I think they fall just below bats, but it depends on what I'm looking at. If I see a rat, he's in first place right then, okay? Rats, bats, and snakes. Well, it wasn't that Asa was wrong in seeking help from physicians, but he was not seeking God. He was depending upon a human remedy instead of a heavenly remedy. And these trials that we go through, whether it's physical, it doesn't mean that God doesn't like you, that God's angry at you. Sometimes it is a way of discipline. That can happen. When Paul wrote to the Corinthians, they were getting drunk at the Lord's table, and he says to them, for this reason, some of you are sick, and some of you have even fallen asleep. He even took some people home. He wanted them to straighten it out. And we need to examine ourselves. When a godly person is no longer following the Lord, that person will not want to hear the truth and may attempt to stop those who are proclaiming what they no longer want to hear. And that was the case with Asa. Suffering has a way of revealing the best or bringing out the worst. In Asa's case, it did not cause him to seek the Lord for help. Instead, he solely turned to the physicians. And you know, struggles, whether it's physical or relational or emotional or spiritual or financial, and we are going to have all of those things throughout our life at some point. Remember when I was a student at Asbury Seminary, there was a point where I didn't have enough money to buy a stamp. And a friend had written me a letter, and it took a long time for me to finally get back to him. And I got back, and I said, I'm sorry, but I couldn't even afford a stamp. Well, he sent me a bunch of stamps then, so, or money or something. I wasn't trying to do that. But God uses those times in our life, times of leanness. So then we're better stewards when there's a time of abundance, isn't it? Then we're more gracious and generous because we know what it's like to be on that other side when you don't have anything. Well, here we see this affliction. You know, even a godly person who has trusted and faithfully served the Lord for decades can fail to finish well. I want to encourage you, and this is my prayer for my life. I want to finish well. Yet even a severe form of affliction may not be enough to cause a person to seek God's help. Let's always be seeking God's help. It's expected that a woman or a man of God should seek the Lord during a time of affliction, and it was evidently expected that Asa would have sought the Lord, but he didn't. Caleb Cotton, he was born in the 1700s. He said this, "It is not until we have passed through the furnace that we are made to know how much dross there is in our composition. Difficulties reveal things." And so, friend, I want to encourage you to be steadfast, unmovable. Let's learn from Asa. Let's finish well. Let's go across that tape. Let's not stop just before. And because God has blessings on the other side. I've shared this with you before, and I close with this, but years ago, I was working for this hired man, and it snowed on Thanksgiving, really bad. And they had a big hill that I had to go 7 miles to where my parents lived, and that's where I was staying during that semester. I'm working for this guy and going to school, and there was this big hill, and I started up that hill, and I got stuck almost to the top, and a guy pulled me up, and then there was a lady, and I knew her. This was 60 miles away from where I grew up, but this lady and had two little kids, and she got up to that point, and then she said, "I'm going back home." She had 60 miles of 50-some miles to go back home. But what happened is when you got out of that hill, the road was completely clear. There wasn't any snow on it. And sometimes we stop just before the other side. You know, she could have had easier driving from that point on. Family missed out on her and the kids. And we need to press on, and let's come across that ribbon and break that ribbon. We're going to have our musicians come back up.
Thank you, Pastor Tom, for that great message. Let's give Pastor Tom a round of applause.
And I rest in my heart. High King of Heaven, my treasure you
musicians. That's awesome. And thank you to all those who joined later. Quite a list of them. We have Korea represented, Kansas represented, lots of places represented. So thank you for joining us. We're going to close now in prayer. Just a couple announcements again. So Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, we'll start our prayer time. And I think we'll probably meet out here. And then on Saturday at 7 o'clock, 7 to 9, we'll have our men's Bible study. We'll start that back up. So let's close in prayer here. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your love for us. You demonstrated your love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And Lord, we think of all the upheaval that's taking place. And Lord, I believe you're trying to get our attention as a nation. We need you. We should long for you. We should run to you. We should acknowledge you. We should serve you and put you first, Lord. You're not going to be allowing us to put you second or third or fourth, but you must be first. And so, Lord, as we come, we pray for those that are here this morning, that your blessing will be upon them, those in different parts of our country and even different parts of the world that are watching. Lord, we thank you for them. We pray that you might take the music or a part of the message or whatever it is to encourage each one to pursue you, to run boldly and quickly and diligently towards you. We pray.